with under 80 women. As-Sakhawi, you know, well, actually, in the second century of Hijra, Ibn Hajar mentioned 824 women who were famous. 824 women in within the 100-year range in the second century. What were they famous of? Of their fiqh and their ilm al-hadith. They were mujtahidat. And these were the famous ones. You know, there are many commons, many below average, many, you know, below the famous status. You have al-Sakhawi mentioned, and this is in the 4th century, he mentioned 1,070 scholar women in the 4th century. 1,070 women scholars. And these, by the way, are not my numbers. These are documented in books of history. Because if you find what they call the books of Rijal, the science of narrators, you find sections that are just for women. Volumes just for women, narrators, women, jurists, women, fuqaha, etc. All of this is something that was common throughout history. And it is not the time to sit and list every single name, but it is sufficient to say there are thousands and thousands and thousands of them. Now, where was that? Did that include every single woman that existed? No, but not every single man was very well known for anything. You know, most of the people do not opt for this. But if you have, at a certain time, you have over 1,000 women who are scholars, like now you come to the year 2010, and you say now we have 100, 200, 300. Now we brag about how many huffaz we have, memorizers of the Quran. You know, we have 1,000, 2,000, etc. in one locality. At that time, you're talking about 1,000 scholars. Their starting step was the memorization of the Quran al-Kareem. You know, and we're talking about these scholars were all women. Of course, when you look at the status of the Muslim women today, it has nothing to do with the past. Because not only did the Muslim women decline, you have to understand something. There was nothing called Muslim women who just went downhill. It was the Muslim Ummah that went downhill. We, as a nation, the best nation, has gone downhill. And part of going downhill, part of this decline in the intellectual level of the Muslim Ummah, women were just part of the process. And of course, we declined due to different reasons. Some of them are internal, some of them are external. But in the decline, you talk about the negligence of the study of Islam, the negligence of the Arabic language, the negligence of the Quran being busied by the jihad which Muslims did throughout their history, etc., neglecting the study of Islam and continuing the building process, the intellectual process while they were expanding, etc. So many factors came in internally, being impacted by foreign civilizations, you know, such as the Hindu civilizations or the Hindu ideas, Greek ideas, etc. It all contributed to the decline of the Muslim woman and the seepage of foreign ideas regarding aqidah, regarding the ibadat, regarding the what they call tasawwuf, regarding the intellect itself, and part of them were also regarding women and the role of women. And part, another external reason, is now, of course, is the westernization. And before I go there, just I want to say that this did not happen over 10 years, 100 years, 200 years. The Muslim Ummah's history is 1,500 years old. So it's taken centuries for Muslims to get from where they were to where they are right now. But in the process, many traditions came up. And if you find in each locality, so you have Arabs and tribes and Bedouins and people have their own tribes and their perception of women because of their ignorance. And they started replacing Islam and the view of Islam. Machoism, if that is a word, came to replace the idea of being the man being the caretaker of the woman. So it's not a matter of taking care of the woman as spending, making sure that she is comfortable, making sure that she is taken care of. You know, that became secondary. What became primary for the man is that I am the boss, meaning the caretaking, what the Quran referred to as al-qawama, became the person with the upper hand that I can hit and I can smack and I can yell and I can do this and that. Something that Islam did not come up with, but it came with the traditions of the people. And with the ignorance of in Islam itself, you know, the values started changing, our view of women started changing, women started changing their view of themselves and their men, etc., etc. as well. The decline was across the board. Absolutely. So now, we have sick traditions. I'll give you one very simple example. If a man in certain areas, a man proposes to a woman, he's not allowed to see her. After they get the engagement, they're allowed to go out together, Muslims. Even though Islam has it exactly the opposite. You have sometimes the father shows up one day and tells the daughter, by the way, you're engaged. Where did that come from? You know, literally, you engaged. I that's it. I gave you two X or Y. Why? I'm your father. It is enough. Even though in Islam, this is not allowed. It is not allowed. The woman has to choose her spouse. But it is the culture, the traditions that we grow up with. And by the way, when I say the father and the grandfather, they don't know any better. I said, I already mentioned their decline. They don't know Islam. They don't know Islam. Take now, you ask an average Muslim, I'm not even talking about the older generation. Look at the current generation, the younger generation. And we, being in the West, are exposed to Islam much more than people in our back countries. Okay? Ask a regular person, how many hours do you spend a day reading? Reading in general. And how many of them do you read about Islam? And when you read about Islam, what do you read? Most of them will be reading about jinn, shayateen, about something that's not related to how you live, how you think, how you interact. Something has nothing to do with reality. As if it becomes an escapism. You know, you live in the ghaib, you live in the unsensed, rather than, you know, we like to talk about the day of judgment, the heaven and hell, so we get goosebumps, and oh, I wish I could go there, oh, I'm afraid to go there. It's just, and then of course it's feelings. And as an emotion, you know, a few minutes, it goes down. And then life continues just the way you were, because there was no idea that is actually controlling you, making you behave in a certain way. So the study of Islam has become almost negligible. You know, even now when we talk about our children, mashallah, my son is a reader. What does he read? Harry Potter. You know, he's going to learn how to fly. You know? But this is now somebody who's actually thinking, somebody who's actually reading rather than playing video games, etc. But this is the status, this is where the position of Muslims in general are in right now. You have, of course, the other part that led to where we are right now. Where, in my view, my humble view, Muslim women as well as men have lost their view of who they are, what it means to be a Muslim, man or woman. Another part of the reason for that, not only the ignorance in Islam itself, but also the crazy campaign, the savage campaign that has been waged against Islam and the Muslims by the West. And this is not to put blame, by the way. Islam attacked the ideas of kufr right and left. In the Quran al-Kareem, in the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Islam attacks the idea of kufr right and left. About people who claim Allah Ta'ala has a son, about people who claim that Allah Ta'ala is three, about people who worship idols, attacked ideas right and left. So here I'm not saying, oh, bad West. That's not my intention at all. They do there what they're convinced of to be in their interest. The question is, what are we doing that is in our interest as a nation, as an ummah, as a Muslim individual who will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So they campaigned against Islam, and they attacked the ideas of Islam. They attacked many ideas. The idea of modesty, that what is the big deal? Why? What is the problem? Why do you have the women sitting on one side, the men on one side? What are you going to eat each other? What's the problem? You know, neglecting this, but this applies to them, this can work for them. People who do not see something called Akhirah, people who decided that it's a secular society altogether. You know, not only that secular society, they actually look down at any idea of religion. They teach the ideas of the natural progression, what they call it, the theory of evolution, the theory of evolution as something as a matter of fact rather than really a theory. So when there is no God and you are not living according to a religious law, or there is no mention of Allah Ta'ala altogether, there is no mention of haram and halal, of course it becomes natural for you to act in whichever way you want, according to the law. So they attack the idea of modesty, they attack the idea of hijab. How can the Muslim woman, you know, live, work in the society, contribute to the society when she's fully covered? As if Aisha radiallahu anha, or Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr, or Nusayba, you know, Mazniya, none of them contributed. They sat home. Why? Because, man, I'm covered up. I can't do a thing. As a matter of fact, it's too tight. I can't even think. What kind of nonsense is that? But they did attack it. And it reached a declined people. It reached people who could not think, who did not understand what Islam says about them, who they are in life. And therefore, when they attacked the hijab, many people, and you have Muslims who came out and said, it's an Arab tradition, man. Arab, no Arabs in the Quran. You know, it's an Arab tradition. It limits the this. And now you have people who have Muslims in Turkey. You have Muslims in Tunis who are, it's against the law to cover up. It's against the law to dress up in a certain way in colleges, etc. Why?